Hi, this is Mike. Welcome to BruTalc. In case it even needed to be said, I'm a dirty boomer. And like any elderly man in his mid-20s, I have a pathological appetite for spending money. In between sips, of course. I bought an HTC Vive in May 2017, so I've had hands-on with it for some time now. VR is exactly what it seems like, simultaneously the coolest and most retarded thing ever created by human hands. The first thing that you'll notice if you're reckless enough to drop nearly $1,000 on one of these toys is how absolutely amazing the technology really is. It's impossible to demonstrate in a 2D video like this one, but VR technology works exactly as advertised. It sells the illusion that you are actually in a virtual three-dimensional space. It does this by simulating how your eyes normally perceive depth. Those of us with two-eye privilege are processing visual input from two different points on our face at all times, so there's a slight difference in perspective between them. The closer objects get to our face, the more pronounced the difference becomes between what each eye is seeing. Likewise, if you move an object farther away, the perspectives between the eyes converge. Virtual reality does the same thing. It shows you two offset digital images, essentially perfectly simulating 3D depth perception. The illusion works. The first time I tried VR, it really felt like I could lean on the desk in front of me in Robo Recall, because every tool of spatial perception I've developed over my whole life tells me that three-dimensional objects can be touched. And while the illusion works very well, the seams start to become apparent over time. There's of course the infamous screen door effect, where a lattice is subtly visible due to how close the display sits to your eyes. Supposedly, the Vive Pro mitigates this with its higher resolution, but at least in the base model Vive I have, it's quite noticeable, and I've heard it's still there to some extent on the Pro. Then there's also the lesser known problems, like when the tracking fucks up and the entire world slides out from underneath you like a rocket ship, or the world flashes out of existence around you for no reason. Proper sensor setup can limit these problems, but never completely eliminate them. And also, if you have a very spacious room to play VR in like I do, then sometimes just the distance between the sensors can generate some of these problems. But on the net, the immersion outweighs the issues. But technical hitches, even minor ones, are especially jarring the more perfectly simulated the experience is. This is true in traditional games too. So for example, a glitch in Red Dead Redemption 2 is more distracting than a ragdoll fucking up in something like Skyrim, and that's owed to the two games' vastly different levels of realism and immersion. Likewise, immersion-breaking seams in VR are quite jarring because of how otherwise immersive VR is. Anyway, technical jankiness aside, let's talk about the games. There's plenty for fat ugly boomers like myself to play. Personally though, I'm not super into racing or cockpit sims, the vroom vroom doesn't do it for me, but it's there if you like that kind of thing. I'm more into shooters and arcade style games, and VR scratches that itch perfectly. As a kid, every summer my brother and I would hit the arcades at the beach. Point Blank, Time Crisis 2, all those light gun games were my fucking jam. I got Time Crisis 3 on my PS2 so I could play it at home, and even younger than that, I was obsessed with Duck Hunt on my dad's NES. So with that background, I can say if I had VR as a kid, it would have blown my fucking mind. Superhot and Robo Recall in particular are the best light gun style games I've ever played. There's no way to communicate this through words alone either. You have to see the bullets whiz past your face. You have to physically throw a knife at an attacker or pluck a bullet out of the air with your bare hands. There simply is no substitute for doing this in a fully simulated 3D space. It just beats the pants off of any similar 2D experience. This particular genre, the arcade shooter, is best realized in virtual reality, without a doubt. Now, the same can't be said for all genres. Third-person games obviously don't make much sense in virtual reality. Some have attempted it, but it's more gimmick than value add there. Also, competitive multiplayer shooters can be frustrating due to limited field of view. I'm thinking Onward and Pavlov here. Also, games with a lot of motion can be a problem. Locomotion is usually done through teleportation or joystick-style movement that many people find nauseating. This means fast-paced shooters like Doom don't really work either. Doom VFR made many compromises versus the vanilla game to make it workable in VR. So, VR has not swooped in to replace 2D gaming, but it has carved out a legit space for itself. And all that said, sometimes games you'd think would never work in VR wind up being surprisingly viable. Minecraft VR, the Vivecraft mod specifically, not the official VR version of the game on Windows, is a perfect example. You can choose to play Vivecraft in standard room-scale kind of setup with the VR wands, but it really shines with a straightforward, standard mouse and keyboard setup. That's right, you can walk around with WASD, look with the mouse, play the full game, sitting down, and totally immersed in VR. Now, it's still Minecraft, so keep that in mind. There's only so much you're gonna squeeze out of this. But you'd be surprised how much life is breathed into this game by playing this way. It's at its best when cave diving, feeling the space around you, peeking around corners, and wondering what's lurking in the darkness around you. Subnautica and The Vanishing of Ethan Carter both feature similar full seated mode support, though you play those with a controller. Honestly, I just wish more VR games had this, but I suspect many developers think joystick or mouse look might be too much for weak boomer stomachs to take. What Vivecraft gets right is that it gives you the option. If moving around with a mouse and keyboard doesn't nauseate you, as it doesn't nauseate me, then you can do that, and that's great. Fallout 4 VR, by contrast, offers no such seated alternative where you look with a joystick or mouse. And for a game as lengthy as Fallout 4, this is a problem. It basically disqualifies me from playing it to completion. That and the fact that the game sucks major dick. And Fallout 4 is about the closest thing to a fully featured, long, AAA video game playable in VR. That's a real disappointment, because I would be happy to play many other existing first-person titles with a simple Vivecraft-style mouse and keyboard conversion. But for now, we're mostly stuck with arcade-style games, Sims, and Sips, most of which will run you 20 to 30 bucks a pop. This is where the real thievery starts to become obvious. So many VR games offer so little, but sport $30 price tags all the same. If these were 2D games, they might be able to get away with a $5 price tag, but the devs know their audience. VR gamers, like myself, have money to blow, and we're starved for content, so developers know that they can get away with highway robbery. Now, a noteworthy exception is VR's best multiplayer game, and it's totally free, Rec Room. Any game that lets you stick a bucket on a screaming 12-year-old's head is automatically a 10 out of 10 in my book. But Rec Room is totally free, and has been receiving constant, substantial updates since launch. Big ups to the guys at Against Gravity. They've made a great game and kept it totally free in order to build a reputation for themselves and VR development experience. Good on them. Anyway, this video's all over the place at this point, so let's wrap it up. Superhot VR, best VR game, honorable mentions, Robo Recall, and Rec Room. VR's expensive as fuck, don't fucking buy it. But if you do, it's alright. Sip life, BruTalc out. Oh, and subscribe, please.